district, Iconium, and Antioch, strengthening the disciples and encouraging them to remain true to the faith. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God, they said. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you, God, for another opportunity to be found in your house. Lord, I pray now that you will decrease this dust and ash that stands here so that we can hear word from you. God, I pray especially for that person who does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Lord, touch them in the way that only you can. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I have some scars, but I'm still here. I have some scars, but I'm still here. In our text, we find that for the sake of the gospel, Paul and Barnabas are teaching and preaching Jesus Christ. Progress needs to happen, and so they tell the people the good news, but not without opposition. You see, there are indeed unbelievers in the crowd, and so these men face some hard times. Paul, the apostle in particular, is stoned at Lystra at the instigation of the Jews. Perhaps this happens to Paul because, you see, Paul was the chief messenger. Unlike Barnabas, Paul was the chief among messengers. And so Paul was stoned. Stoning is a method of capital punishment. It is said that in some cultures, people are still stoned today. It's whereby a group of people throw stones at the subject until he or she dies. After 20 minutes, the executioners go and they check for death. It's a harsh form of torture. Can you see Paul? Perhaps he's in the middle of a field somewhere, buried up to his chest. Do you see Paul? Everyone circled around him. He watches as one takes a stone in hand and another takes a stone in hand. Paul just waiting for the next stone. Stones that are large enough to cause life-ending damage, but small enough not to kill immediately. You see, stoning was to be a slow form of torture. You weren't supposed to die right away. It was to be painful and deliberate death. Look at Paul as each stone is thrown. Look at Paul. Can you see the blood on his face? Teeth knocked out of his mouth. Cuts and bruises. Can you see the swelling of his eyes? Knots on his head. Shortness of breath. Unbearable physical pain. He was stoned so badly, the Bible tells us that they thought he was dead. Paul looked like what he'd been through. Many times we get really happy when we're able to stand up and testify and say, "Church, I don't look like what I've been through." But that would not be Paul's testimony. You see, this man has just been stoned and he looks like. He looks like what he's been through. Look at Paul, left for dead. He's in such critical condition. He had some scars. What we see in this text is a Christian man deeply wounded. They drug Paul out of the city. Paul, being the man that he was, may not have even been able to talk about his pain. You know, many times in societies, men aren't able to talk about their pain, but this is a Christian man who is in some pain. In Paul's life, we can see more and more that his life was really about service and suffering. Paul's entire life, he had to deal with some heavy things. Being a Christian, from what we can see in Paul's life, can be hard. Paul had just healed a man in this text, And when the people saw that Paul had done such healing, they thought he was a god. They thought Paul was perhaps Hermes. And so if Paul was a god, this means that he could be enthroned or he could be enshrined because he was a god. They wanted to sacrifice to both he and Barnabas. Oh, Paul is a god. They were comfortable with Paul being a god, but they weren't comfortable with him being a Christian, faithful minister. So then Paul is suffering because he was trying to do right. So many Christians try to do right, but it seems that when the Christian tries to do right, he or she still finds themselves suffering. They still find trouble knocking on the door. I'm trying to do the right thing. Trouble is finding me. You know, sometimes bad things happen to good people. Christians suffer. In the book, God of the Oppressed, Dr. James Cone, he wrestles with this idea of Christian suffering. He says that the problem in Scripture is not why suffering exists, but why it afflicts some people and not others. He says the problem is not the fact of suffering, but its distribution. Why do the wicked prosper while those who try to keep the faith in God suffer? I try to do the right thing and I suffer. I try to say the right things, but I still suffer. I give my tithes and my offering, but I suffer. I come to Mount Peace, maybe 810 and 1159, and I still suffer. I don't curse as much as I used to, but I still suffer. I didn't smack the daylights out of them this time, but I still suffer. I didn't even cut them to the white meat, but I still suffer. Being a believer can be hard. Trying my best to be a good Christian, an upstanding citizen in my community, I'm trying to build some things up, but I still find my face right there with a stone. I see stones coming at me day after day after day. And as a Christian, not only do I have to consider stones, but I have to consider stone throwers. Paul was there and these people were circled around him. He had to look into the eyes of his haters. And you see, the thing about stone throwers is that because of the stoning activity, no one could claim that they actually killed the subject. It wasn't my stone. I participated in some things, but it wasn't me. You see, the world would throw stones of pain and then claim no assault. I didn't mean it like that. You took it the wrong way. You need to check your heart. You're too sensitive. I was just following the norm. But my question to the stone thrower would be, how do you know it wasn't your stone that hurt someone? How do you know it wasn't your stone that discouraged someone? How do you know that it wasn't your stone that broke someone down? If you're going to have a stone in your hand, use it to build people up. Some things need to be built. If you have a stone, use it for the upbuilding of the kingdom. And perhaps someone is here on this morning and you know you've been hurt by some stones and your pain has been put on public display. I want you to know that God specializes in easing some pain. And the good thing about God is that my pain may be on display today, but my victory is going to be on display tomorrow. So I don't care about your stones. Because being a Christian may be hard, but I can hold on because God has something to show the world. Paul's life was marked by suffering and serving, serving and suffering. The fact is, it's a good thing that there were people there to support Paul. Because even through the pain, the Bible tells us that they stood around him. They gathered around Paul to guard him against further outrage of the people. So he had some good Christian support. And Christian support is absolutely necessary. And when we as Christians, those of us who are believers, when we start to fail at supporting one another, especially in the Baptist church, we must revisit our Baptist covenant. You see, it is our responsibility to be support for one another. The Baptist covenant simply tells us we engage to watch over, to pray for, to exhort and stir up each other unto every good word and work, to guard each other's reputation, not needlessly exposing the infirmities of others, to participate in each other's joys, and with tender sympathy, bear one another's burdens and sorrows. Christian support is needed. These people stood around Paul even when he was down, even when he was weak. If you're strong, this is the opportunity for you to help someone who is not as strong. Support. Gathering around, and I know that Mount Peace knows this, because when I joined Mount Peace in 2012, I'll never forget, one of the first funerals I came to was that of Mr. David Rollins. Mr. David was a kind man. I remember Pastor Terry telling us that Mr. David, his family was somewhere else, but we were his family. I remember Pastor Terry saying the same thing he says about other people and their families and when these people die. He'll say, we need to be supported. I remember coming to that funeral, and I've attended many funerals at many churches. I was a new member at this church. I came to the funeral, and when I walked in, I remember thinking, I thought Pastor Terry said this man didn't have any family down here. I looked around, and all I could see was members of Mount Peace Baptist Church, just showing that you do know how to be Christian support. All I'm doing is encouraging you to keep on being that support. Because people are hurting in our congregation. They may not say anything to you, but they're hurting. They may wear a smile, but they're hurting. They may come to Sunday school and Bible study. They may sing in the choir. They may play the instruments and stand at the door. But at the end of service, they go home crying. But before they leave service, make sure that you give them an embrace. Make sure that you show them love. Make sure that you encourage them. Keep on being good Christian support. Being a Christian is not always easy. Sometimes being a Christian is not easy even in the church. But we keep on going. You see, different personalities, different attitudes. People will be people. But we all have the same father. So it was difficult for Paul to do what he did. And he absolutely had that Christian support. But Paul did exhibit some strength, because the text tells us that he got up. Paul got up, and he didn't just get up. The Bible says he restored the faith of others. So this means that Paul didn't let stones get in the way of his assignment. They drew him out of the city, but they didn't draw him from his assignment. They beat him and hurt him, but they didn't hurt his witness. You see, because no matter how much pain he felt, God was still good. No matter how hurt he was, God was still worthy to be praised. No matter what he went through, people needed to hear about Jesus Christ. So Paul got up, came into the city again. I'm coming back to let you know that I don't fear you. He went back into the same city with those stone throwers. He gets up, he goes back in, and although he was down, what I like about this text is that if the people gathered around him, that means that Paul was on the ground. If Paul was on the ground, he had to look up in order to see those people. If Paul was on the ground, he had to look up in order to get up. And what I'm telling you today is that if you can look up, you can get up. You see, if you're down, you're in a good position to look up. I may be hurt, but I can look up. I might be broke, but I can look up. I may be discouraged, but I can look up. I may be sad, but I can look up. I may feel like I don't have a friend in the world, but I can look up. I'm going through a lot of things, but I can look up. to look up. Paul looked up and he got up. We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. We're perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not abandoned. We're struck down, but not destroyed. Look up so you can get up. You have to go by the cross, but if you keep on moving, you're going to reach the crown. There is some suffering to be had. I know there's suffering to be had. Paul and Barnabas, they told the people, hey, we must go through hardships. But they didn't stop there. We must go through hardships. Why? How? What? We must go through hardships to enter the kingdom of God. So that means that although there are difficult times, I'm on my way somewhere. So I have to keep going. On Wednesday night after vacation Bible school, I left here. I was in my car. There was thunder. There was lightning. I was driving, and when I got off my exit, there was complete darkness. I was on the phone with my aunt, and I said to her, I said, you know what? I have some food that I want to put in the microwave when I get there, so I hope the power is on when I reach my destination. So she said, well, you never know. It could be a difference on the other side. She said, you just have to keep on going. So it was darkness on every hand. I mean, the restaurants were dark. The signal lights were dark. The gas stations were dark. The only light you could see was the car in front of you. I drove through the darkness. But the good news is I drove through the darkness. Because by the time I got home, I was in the light. And all I'm trying to tell you, church, is if you're dealing with darkness right now, just keep on going. Because there's light on the other side of darkness. Paul faced darkness throughout his entire ministry, but he kept on going because he couldn't clock out because he was still on the job. And all I'm telling you now is that you can't clock out because you're still on the job. You can't clock out because there's still work to do. You can't clock out because Jesus needs you. You can't clock out because the kingdom of the Lord is at hand. You've got work to do. And see, when you get there, you won't need that 401k. When you get there, you won't need an IRA. They can keep all of those vacation days. You see, because you've got something greater on the way. But you have to keep going. So Paul faced some darkness. Humanity, we face some hard times. This is true. But every time Paul got up, keep reading, continue reading, read about the life of Paul. Shipwreck, he was beat, all of these things in chains, in prison. So many things happened to Paul, but he kept going. And every time he was down, he got up. And you know, that reminds me of somebody else who got up. Some things happened, but he got up. He was mocked, but he got up. He was beaten, but he got up. He was bruised, but he got up. He had nails in his hands, but he got up. He had nails in his feet, but he got up. He was pierced in his side, but he got up. A crown of thorns on his head, but he got up. And I tell you this, no matter what I face in this life, because Jesus got up, McCoy is going to get up every time. I may be down sometimes, but McCoy is going to get up. Because this world didn't give me my joy, and this world can't take it away. And so Jesus got up so we can get up. And you know, this was really, 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 really real to me when I was in my 20s. You see, when I was in my 20s, a lot of people don't know this. I've never told this story publicly. But my life as a young person was difficult. I had self-esteem issues. I had people problems. I wanted to get my education, but I didn't think I was smart enough. I had issues with SAT, ACT, and all of the other types of standardized tests, you see, because I learned differently, but I didn't know that at the time. So when I was in my early 20s, I was suicidal. I lived in a one-bedroom apartment, and I was there by myself. And at that point of suicide, I had a knife in the one hand, and I had pills in the other hand. Now, I was a bit cowardly, so I didn't use the knife. But I did swallow those pills. I remember I was sitting on my kitchen floor, young, young, young. I was sitting there on the kitchen floor, and I put those pills in my mouth. And I remember this is a time in my life where I know I certainly heard the voice of the Lord, because I swallowed those pills. And when I started to gag, I could hear the voice of the Lord say, "You didn't give yourself life, so you can't take it away." So all I'm saying is that I was at that point where I almost let go. I was at that point where I didn't want to take life anymore. I was at that point where I didn't understand why I was here. Why does it matter? There's so many people on the planet anyway. And God said, "But there's only one you." So I held on, and I want everybody to know that almost does count sometimes, because I said, I almost let go. I said, I almost let go. I almost let go. And so every time I sit and I think about that time in my life, I'm reminded, and I had to tell it today, church, that I almost let go. I felt like I just couldn't take life anymore.
God bless you.